Hi, I'm Lauren Salazar, the wood cellar manager and blender here at New Belgium Brewing Company in beautiful Fort Collins, Colorado, and you are watching the Beer Diaries.
How's it going?
Good, how are you?
Good, I'm Greg from the Beer Diaries.
I'm Michael from New Belgium.
Thanks for having us. I mean, this is an amazing place. I mean, you never know what the place is like till you come here. Expectations were high, and this blows it away.
Oh, well, thank you very much. Thank you very much. It's a pleasure to have you guys here.
Been a long trip, though. I'm real thirsty.
You want some beer?
Yeah.
All right, let's have some beer.
Awesome, let's roll.
Yeah.
After you?
Thank you.
So we'll saddle up to the bar, or is it sidle? It's sidle up to the bar, I think.
Saddle up. You want to drink a roly poly?
I would love to drink a roly poly.
Maybe Dan can get us a roly poly.
Two roly polies.
Yes,
absolutely.
It's a nice summer ale.
Yeah, that's your summer seasonal. Yep. Is that right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's got monk fruit and sour sop in it. It's super refreshing, light, crisp.
Awesome.
Just kind of easy drinking. It's named after a very traditional Belgian yard game.
Yeah, it's what kind of rolling.
Yeah, it's similar to bocce, but you use things that look like big cheese wheels.
It's Belgian.
It's very Belgian in nature.
Yeah. Well, yeah. One thing about the taproom that I think is awesome, it's mm-hmm. obviously some lips of faith here on some really unique stuff. I mean, you got a big lineup of the regular stuff, some interesting stuff, and then really interesting stuff.
Yeah, you know, it's everything. The taproom is about the only place in the Thank you very much, Dan.
Cheers
to you. Yeah.
It's the only place in the world that's...
That you can pretty well get everything that's currently available from us. We've got it on tap here.
Ooh, that's nice.
Yeah, it's nice, easy. Refreshing. Very refreshing. Nice summer beer. It's a summery day outside.
Yeah. So. Nice. And we got a lot of work to do, so we're going to use this beer to give us sustenance through the tour.
Absolutely. You want to hit Brewhouse 1?
Yeah, Brewhouse 1.
Let's do it.
All right, I'll follow you. And we are in a brewhouse.
Absolutely.
You can feel it.
Yeah, it's warm. Smells wonderful.
Yeah, it's in that porridgey, delicious, awesomeness.
Yeah, it's super nice. Sort of smells like grape nuts if you soak it in warm water.
Yeah. So this was the original brew house here in the facility.
Yeah, we call this the mothership, right? And the mothership's at 500 Linden Street.
Mothership Witt?
Yeah, similar. Yeah. And so 500 Linden here opened up in 1995, and so this is a 100 barrel brew house that was commissioned in December of that year.
Right.
We were founded a few years before that in a basement.
It's like
on the west side of town. 91. Yeah. So in the early days, it was Kim and Jeff brewing, bottling, and selling Fat Iron Abbey and bombers out of their basement.
But so, there's some old equipment there.
Yeah, that's actually the old equipment right there.
That's amazing. I mean, it's funny because a lot of breweries, I mean, they really maintain their roots. So you go to most of them, they'll often have their original equipment still in the brew house, probably not being used.
Yeah.
That looks a little lower tech than this stuff.
It was homemade.
Really?
Jeff was an engineer and built all the equipment himself. And
that's pretty cool.
That carried over to where he built all the programming for our current systems and all of that.
Nice.
The most amazing thing about that equipment, though, is number one, we started on it, but two, we went from this to this in just 4 years.
Like, I mean, because that one, barrel?
Yeah, it's about four barrels, give or take.
It's 100. Wow.
Yeah, so from June of 91 to December of 95.
That's incredible.
Yeah, it was a fast transition.
So any other things about this room? I mean, I noticed this gigantically cool window.
Yeah, there's this giant cool window that brings in a lot of light. And lets
the
brewers,
kind of a cathedral window.
Yeah, you know, lets the brewers work in natural light and all of that.
Cool, man. So what would we see after this?
Yeah, we're going to head into Brewhouse 2. So we went from a 100 barrel system to a 200 barrel system in a very short time as well.
So, of course, the history of New Belgium is pretty interesting, where it came from.
Sure, yeah. So we were founded in 1991. A couple years before that, Jeff Liebisch was pedaling a bicycle through Belgium. He was an avid home brewer and an engineer and just sort of loved all things beer, and again, specifically Belgian beer. And so he found himself bike touring around Belgium, kind of trying to discover the best and brightest of Belgian beers, as it were. And so he's pedaling around, going to all the famous spots, and he ends up at a little bar in Bruges called the Berche, and gets kind of a one-on-one audience with the owner there, and ends up sitting through a great 2-hour conversation about the history and love of Belgian beers. And we like to think that right there on that bar stool in the Bruges Berche, the seed for the New Belgium Brewing Company was planted.
So like that light went on, you go, wait a minute.
Totally. He's like, I could take my love for homebrewing and turn it into a profession and bring Belgian beers to the U.S. Because at that point, nobody was really brewing Belgian beers.
And the name New Belgium.
Absolutely. Yeah, and so took a couple years of, you know, raising finances, refining recipes, you know, trying to figure out how to build a production brewery in the basement of your own house. But the next thing you know, June of 91 rolls around.
Right.
They have Abbey, our Belgian double, as well as Fat Tire, our Amber, which is a, you know, traditional Belgian style as well.
Cool.
22-ounce bottles. They'd load them up into the trunk of Kim's car, and Kim would then just drive around and sell beer.
Very cool.
Yeah,
that's
so
awesome. Speaking of growth,
yeah,
we are underneath the, like, mega brew house.
Totally, yeah. So this is a 200-barrel system. So, you know, we started with that initial system we saw in Brew House 1 and then moved into Brew House 1 and then, of course, into here in about 2000, late 2000, this was commissioned.
Okay.
And sure enough, it's a 200-barrel system that can pump about 12 batches through a day.
Wow. And it goes, and it starts, I mean, these are the tanks underneath here.
This is quite literally the, you know, the system, as it were.
Right, right.
All the brewers work down here. It's a little easier to see upstairs, so maybe we want to go up there.
So this is an amazing room. Like this, like the ceiling, the mosaics.
Yeah, it's well thought out. You know, I think one of the things, you know, in the early days, Kim really wanted to keep our aesthetic going. And, you know, it's one of those, she wanted to make the room pretty. And she wanted
sure is.
Like, have a place for all of us to hang out. You know, typical, you know, grain to hot work, as
yeah,
it were.
Yeah.
But all of our grain is actually kept just, you know, north of here in its own set of silos. We call that building the malt castle. The brewers,
for obvious reasons.
Yeah, totally. The brewers, they sit downstairs in an office, and
yeah,
you know, they hit the whatever they're brewing. They hit the different malt bills. It comes shooting across, and it actually falls into here, our wet mill. So the dry grain fills it up. Hot water from the back tank will meet it there. So that's where the water and the grain meet for the first time.
Yep.
So we get it nice and soggy, run it through a couple sets of mill rollers, and then the beat up stuff comes right here to the mash tun. A little bit more added, a little bit more water added, stews in there, you know, drawing out all that fun stuff. Pushes to the Lauter tun, which is just past it. Lauter's a German word, I think it means fancy colander. sort of drains the liquids and the solids.
Yeah.
And then the liquid heads over to the next tank, which is the pre-run vessel, kind of a staging tank, so we can run the boil kettle and the Lauter tun at the same time.
Okay.
And then just past that is the Merlin boil kettle. So,
and the Merlin boil kettle is a pretty unique device, right?
It's a totally unique device. It's not unique to us, but it's unique in that there's not very many of them. Ours was the first one in North America.
Oh, cool.
Instead of taking you know, your wort and putting a heat source underneath it and heating it from the bottom, it actually fountains the wort up and spritzes it in thin sheets across a, like a heated cone. Cone kind of looks like a wizard's hat. That's
what they
call it, the Merlin boil
kettle. Ah, there you go.
Yeah, and so it's that cone is heated very hot, and it flash boils that wort. So we can put 200 barrels to a rolling boil in about 45 minutes.
Wow. So heading towards the wood cellar.
Yep, well, we like to call it the cache le fooder. So fooder is a Flemish word. I'm pretty sure it means giant oak barrel.
Yeah. And that's where a lot of the barrel aging goes? Is that
absolutely. All of our barrel aging happens in there.
So. This is the place.
Yeah.
What do we find in here, I wonder?
Giant wood barrels.
Giant. Yeah. Man, and they are giants.
Yeah, they're big ones. So these are our fooders, right? So we put two different types of beer in here. The dark one is Oscar and the light one is Felix.
As in the Odd Couple.
As in the Odd Couple.
But they mix so well.
They do, yeah. So Oscar becomes La Folie, and Felix is the blend that generally becomes everything else. So this is just straight unblended Oscar. So you can imagine the complexities of several different versions of Oscar to create just one La Folie.
Whew, lovely. Brown sugar and sour.
Yeah, sour indeed.
Yeah,
very cherry. But
yeah, cherry, but also like sweetness too.
Yeah, I like to think of like plum skins too. That's another big one.
That's actually really lovely, just unblended.
Right? Oh yeah.
And so these incredibly big barrels. I mean, so what happens? I mean, you put the beer in there and then there's, what goes on when it's in there?
Well, so we put the beer in there and it's finished beer. So it goes through the brew house, it goes through the cellar.
It's a beer
so
you could drink.
It's quite literally a beer that you could drink. And then we put it into these barrels. And in these barrels lives basically, you know, the microbial jungle that creates sour beers. So they're French white oak and it's dark, it's rich in alcohol. and it's cool. So there's very few bugs that can live in that,
yeah.
But the ones that do are the delightful ones.
Well, also very high acid. So the high acid, I mean, that's what gives the sourness, is the acidity.
That is the sour punch in there. And so what happens in the barrels is a process known as oxygen diffusion. So the oak, it holds the liquid in, but allows oxygen to come in from the
kind of slowly.
Yeah,
comes
totally.
Through.
And so it comes through, it feeds those bugs in there, and then the byproduct of that feeding is all of these lovely sour flavors.
So this obviously is pretty impressive.
Yeah, so this is the sort of the outside half of the cellar, as it were. When we opened in 95, we had 6 500 hectoliter fermenters. Okay. Hectoliter is about 26 and a half gallons, to give you a general idea. Through the years, actually since 95, 20 something expansions to the footprint of our building.
Wow, that's amazing.
And a lot of those have happened here in the fermentation.
Just kind of keeps going boom, boom,
boom. We just keep adding more and more tanks. And the tanks we add are keep getting bigger and bigger. And so this last several are 2,200 hectoliters a piece, which is about 2,000 hectoliters of beer, 200 hectoliters of headspace.
So how many barrels a year last year do you guys do?
Approaching 800,000 last year.
Wow, that's a lot of beer, actually.
It's a lot of beer. And then the other highlight you can see from here is this pipe above us is actually running finished beer from the store, finished cellar all the way out here to the Thunderdome, so we could poke a hole in that.
And the Thunderdome is where you package.
Yep, it's the bottling hall specifically is the Thunderdome. We call it that because the folks who work in packaging got to name their own building.
Oh, there you go.
So they came up with the Thunderdome.
That's pretty loud, probably.
Yeah, absolutely, yeah. And then the canning line was added to that just past there.
It's on the back part.
The back half, it was in addition to the building, so we go ahead and call that Beyond Thunderdome.
So bottling like crazy here.
Yeah, absolutely. So it's it runs 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, generally speaking. Of course, maintenance shutdowns, so on and so forth. But yeah, it does. The filler runs 700 bottles a minute. We just keep cranking.
Wow.
Yeah. So it right now we're packaging, like we said, we're packaging loft, and so really just kind of running for the next little while. Who knows on loft, and then we'll switch over.
Is there do you guys do 22-ounce bottles here as well?
We do. So it'll take about 2.5 to 3 hours to repurpose all the equipment to run 12-ounce and 22s. So we try to generally run, all of the 22s at once.
Very cool. I mean, the other thing I love is that screen, the public screen that folks can look at, it just sort of shows you just how many you're cranking. It's like a 330,000
bottles since midnight last night.
That's insane.
Yeah.
So we're here in the world of canning.
Yeah, absolutely. Beyond Thunderdome.
Yep.
Yeah, so
it's quiet here, though. It's not on.
Yeah, it's not running. So again, we only really run cans, some to several days a week. At this point, based on our distribution footprint, we can grow still into the more states we can grow into and still produce those cans from this facility.
Which beers do you can?
Right now we do Sunshine Wheat for a Colorado only craft. And then of course Fat Tire, Ranger, and Shift. And all three of those are 12-ounce and 16-ounce cans.
It's a really amazing facility.
Oh, thanks.
You've been a great host. Really appreciate you taking us on.
I appreciate that. Well, thanks for coming.
Thank you.
It was great hanging out.
Thanks for the beers.
Oh, my pleasure.
Yeah. Awesome. Thank you. Greg Beer! Hey, folks. I'm Greg from the Beer Diaries. I am here at New Belgium Brewing, having an amazing day. Going to try some amazing beers. Here with Grady Hull. He's the assistant brewmaster, and we are going to enjoy ourselves, talk about beer, and try a couple.
Oh.
So thanks so much for having us. Really appreciate it.
Oh, my pleasure. Thanks for coming by.
Yeah. So how long you been with New Belgium for?
17 years.
Has it changed a lot in the time you've been here? Like, have you seen a lot of the changes happen?
Yeah, it's changed quite a bit. I mean, the growth has been quite a lot. And I remember when I first started working in the lab here, we were brewing maybe six to nine times a week. And that was in one brew house. And now, we're brewing two brew houses around the clock. So.
And it was 96. Which brew house was, how many barrels was that brew house when you were here?
The one that we're in now, it's a 100 barrel brew house. So,
that was big for that time, wasn't it?
Yeah, it was, like I said, 6 to 9 brews a week. We had, I was in the lab and you pretty much just did everything back then because it wasn't that much beer to,
Did you do your homebrew back in the day? Is that where you started?
Oh yeah. I think a lot of people in this industry, a lot of craft brewers started with homebrewing, of course. I used to brew all the time actually, and that's how I got into, I changed my major and decided that's what I wanted to do a long time ago.
Did you go to school with the intent to get into brewing?
Yeah. When I was, before I discovered homebrewing, I didn't, but once somebody showed me how to homebrew, I changed my major to food science and I've kind of been on it ever since.
Did you ever brew professionally before you were here at all, or?
I did. Well, out of college, I did an internship at Coors where I worked in the sensor department.
Oh, cool.
And then I worked for some brew pubs, a local brew pub here called Cooper Smith's. And another brew pub called Fleetside.
And so with the pilot brewing, I mean, just the general idea, like, w- w- is,
Is that where you guys come up with new recipes, or how do you guys? So talk a little about that process. What that's like?
Yeah, to me that's the funnest part. Is the pilot brewery is where we do new product development. So we can a lot of times we get to just come up with new ideas, or we'll have some direction of something that the company wants.
Some will say like, hey, we want a summer ale. What would you do for this for a new summer ale?
Yeah, exactly. Like Roly Boly, for example, it was real open. They just said, make a summer beer.
Really?
Yeah. But whereas with the other beers, like with the Ranger, we specifically knew we wanted to make an IPA.
Obviously, and I think Rampant is like your newest, like one of your newer regular beers, like it's double IPA. Mm-hmm. Like what kind of things went into it? Did you say, hey, we want to try different types of hops? Or what, do you think of, obviously there's different styles of Imperials and double IPAs you can make. Like how did that all come about?
Yeah, well, so I mean, it kind of starts with a high-level discussion of what do we want? You know, do we want Ranger's big brother, or do you want something that's different from Ranger? And in this case, we decided we didn't want it to just be a bigger Ranger. We wanted it to be totally different. So that was kind of fun because we started chasing down different avenues of hops.
And you guys use some pretty interesting hops in there, don't you? Like
yeah. And that's kind of sort of the challenge because with Ranger we have more of the traditional Cascade. Some different things in there, like Simcoe and Chinook, to give it some variety, but it's a lot of Cascade.
Yeah.
Whereas Rampant, we didn't want to do that, so it was kind of a challenge just finding a totally different backbone for it, Centennial and Calypso. So
in terms of working here, obviously one of the things you read about the company, it's one of the best places in America to work. What kind of perks do employees enjoy? I mean, it's just, you can see there's already a great feeling here, like it's a really warm, open, welcoming place. But You haven't worked here for a while. What kind of benefits or what kind of things really stand out to you?
Free beer?
Well, that would improve any workplace, without a doubt.
But no, you get your first year, you get a bike. After 1 year of working here, you get a cruiser bike.
Oh, cool.
Which is pretty cool. And then after 5 years, you get a trip to Belgium, which is really, really fun.
Wow. Yeah. Do a whole bunch of you guys go, like they kind of all, they bounce up all the people and they all go together?
Yeah, a huge group of us that are in the same class, whenever we were hired.
That sounds really sounds really dangerous.
It is. It's a lot of fun.
What did you remember it really well? Like it was a while ago for you, but I mean, like, what do you like? Did you go to some of the famous breweries, or how did that kind of?
Yeah. It's awesome because my boss Peter Buchart, the brewmaster here, is from Belgium. He was the brewmaster at Rodenbach, and so he knows all the breweries there.
Oh, well, yeah.
Yeah, he knows all the breweries there, and he knows. He kind of schedules it out so that everyone gets to really experience Belgium. Culture,
right,
and specifically Belgian brewing culture. So we'll hit a lot of the famous Trappist breweries, other breweries like Rodenbach, and it's a really awesome.
That's a pretty cool experience. I mean, one thing to call out, obviously, I think we right in the middle here, we got a couple. I mean, Fat Tire and Abbey, very early Belgian styles in North America. I mean, New Belgium is probably one of the first that was doing Belgian style. What's different, I guess, about Belgian style brewing than traditional?
In Belgium, they have, you have your Trappist styles, but you have this, there's, beers with spices. Fat Tire is actually modeled after a pretty common, or at least at the time, I don't know anymore, but it was the most common Belgian ale, which was like a palm or Deconic, an amber ale, which is very, very prevalent in Belgium.
Right.
So Jeff Liebisch, one of our co-founders, when he took his bike ride through Belgium, he went mountain biking through Belgium, and sort of discovered Belgian beer culture and sort of fell in love with it. That's actually where the Fat Tire comes from, because he was riding a mountain bike, which at the time of 10 speeds looked a little different, and they called it a Fat Tire.
Yeah. And so was he, and he came up with the original recipes, I presume, as well.
I think a lot of people think of Belgian beers as they had to be so far out there and so wacky and zany, but really this was a very, probably the most common, most prevalent Belgian ale, that style, that amber ale.
I think kind of what happens is the beer geeks are always searching for crazier flavors and bigger, more explosive tastes. And then you're like, you forget that I think not every, you can't drink those beers every day, right? There's sort of daily drinking beers that were actually very popular, and that style is one of them. One thing that's interesting too, you'd be probably ideal to answer this, is just how do you keep the beer so consistent?
Well, for sure, I think it starts with people. I mean, we have a great group of people here that care a lot about making a quality product and making it the same every time. And when something goes wrong, the way our company culture is set up, it's okay to speak up and say, I messed up. Sometimes if you have a culture where people get hammered down too much, mistakes don't get reported.
They kind of brush under the carpet and kind of...
Yeah, but here there's no fear of getting hammered down if you tell someone you made a mistake and we can, we need to fix that or do whatever, realize the mistake's there. We don't just bottle it. But a lot of it, automation, like a lot of our systems run on programs so that the timing of, spice and hop additions are consistent. The weight of raw materials is consistent.
Mm-hmm. You still have to put some of the stuff in by hand, though, I think, right?
Sure, yeah. But But once it's loaded in, it gets dosed by a timer.
Oh, I see. So there's a pre-vessel that you put it into, and then it gets... It's like a hop cannon type thing, or any of those, sort of not quite like that?
Just raw materials like spices or whatever, hops. You know, it depends on the system. In this brew house, they literally do just open the door and throw them in.
Okay.
But so we work towards the different levels of automation, different things to try to make sure that the boil times are consistent and all that. And then I guess the biggest factor would be our quality assurance department.
When beer's made, there's a bunch of folks that test it, right?
We have a great microbiology, chemistry, and sensory quality assurance departments.
Still the same sensory program you started?
I was at Coors in their sensory department a long time ago, and so that's kind of how I got my job here, was to start up a sensory program here.
And is it kind of the program similar still, like after all these years, or?
It's
evolved with the times.
Yeah, I'd love to say that it's
a long time though.
Yeah.
One particular series I'm curious about is like the Lips of Faith series. Like, how did that kind of come about? What's been the philosophy behind it? What are you guys trying to accomplish with it?
I feel like it started out sort of like we had this theory about wanting to tap into the creativity of our coworkers, like not just having a few people making the beers, but having ideas come from everywhere. And so we started up a program where we had this kind of goofy contest where we would make a pitcher of three different beers blended together, and whoever could guess the beer in the right ratio would get to make the next beer.
Oh, really? All right, cool.
Yeah. So it was kind of a way to give people an opportunity to come up with the next beer. And then it sort of evolved into Lips of Faith, where it was more, kind of comes from everywhere, but a lot of times it was one of our brewers or whatever coming up with a great idea and wanting to,
try it out.
Wanting to let that out, yeah. And I think one of the most exciting things, for me at least, is that a lot of our collaborations with other breweries, so.
Yeah, that's one thing I was noting, is that I think there was one guy on the internet had asked, I think he was with Alpine Brewing, had done a special IPA, and I mean...
Due to CL, Brewery Vivant.
Yeah.
We've got a few more in the works, so we're always, it's always fun to... work with other breweries, because then we're not only getting ideas from our coworkers, but we're also getting ideas from other brewers.
So how's that work, like, for a collaboration? You just call them up and say, hey, we want to do a beer with you?
Email back and forth, shooting ideas back and forth, and like, oh, I love that idea, let's do this, and then someone else will add something else.
And do any of the collaborations come back? Like, do you ever redo some of the most favorite collaborations in Lips of Faith? Like, do they, I know some of these, like, again, like La Folie, and Transatlantique Creek, these are stalwarts of the program, and they are...
Right.
Kick-ass beers. How about some of the other more obscure ones that you guys do? They ever come back, or is that something that, if it becomes real popular, you might do? Or,
well, I mean, I know you already pointed it out, but Transatlantic Creek actually is a collaboration.
Oh, that's right.
First one. It's a collaboration with a Belgian.
And they make part of the beer there and bring it over. Can you talk a bit about that process, how that works? Like,
yeah, well, it's a lambic brewery, so one of the things is kind of like champagne. It's not technically champagne if it doesn't come from the Champagne Valley.
Yeah, yeah.
So with lambics, it's not really to call it a lambic. Technically, it should come from the Lambic Valley.
Yeah, yeah.
I don't know if it's a valley, but
so it's a region.
Yeah, a region.
Yeah.
He makes a traditional cherry lambic. Typically, you would make a lambic and then a young beer.
Yeah.
Maybe blend them. You know, that would be a goose.
And then
if you add cherries to Creek, raspberries, framboise, peaches, and bêche.
Right.
So this is a cherry lambic that's brewed in Belgium. And we do the young beer,
blend them.
And when you marry them, all kinds of things happen. I think the two beers by themselves aren't really that approachable. They're pretty rough. Like pure cherry lambic is pretty tart.
So you'd have it and you're like, whoa, that's a tough one.
Yeah, some people love it, but the base beer we make is pretty sweet and goopy. But you marry them all the polyphenols from one mix up with all the proteins from the other, and it gets all chunky, and you filter that all that chunk out, and it makes a really beautiful product, I think.
Very interesting. How do you, I can't imagine, some of the logistic challenge of, like, just the amount of beer that you guys make and the varieties. There must be some kind of master scheduling program that, because there's so many pieces to the brewing process. It's not just the brewing, but it's which fermenter, how long, when does it bottle? Like, how does that whole process work here? Is that something that you're involved in your role?
No, it's pretty much a guy named Jack Joyce.
He's the master.
Yeah, he pretty much is the gatekeeper of when things get brewed, he's the
conductor. He's like trains, right? Like, he's like train conductor.
Yeah, he goes off of the packaging schedule and kind of works back to what needs to get brewed when.
I mean, you mentioned earlier about sort of working with the other brewers and how you kind of collaboratively brew with some of the local guys. How about the community in general? Like, I mean, I've heard a lot of folks will help each other out a lot. Like, if someone's out of an ingredient it's funny with you guys, because I don't think there's many people you guys could go to say, hey, we need
10,000 pounds of pale malt. Can you like lend it to us? Like, but I mean, I'm sure folks come to you with like, say, hey, I need X, Y, or Z, or how does that whole interface with the other breweries work?
I think the craft brewing community is really cool in that respect. And I have, on more than a few occasions, called up Odell's and asked him if I could borrow, you know, bum a box of hops.
Oh, really?
Awesome. Oh, yeah.
That's
yeah.
Very cool.
Yeah, because, you know,
we're all pretty close friends. You're in the community, yeah.
And then if people need something from us, for sure, yeah, we try to reciprocate that.
I mean, again, it seems very consistent with your culture. I mean, like, community involvement and all that stuff. One question I thought was really important is, when's the last time you brewed on these?
I've never seen anyone brew on these.
You guys should do that. This is, like, try and take out this. Like, I mean, this stuff, it's almost like a mini museum, isn't it?
It is, and it's exactly what it is.
Like,
I don't even know where the stuff existed for a while because it sort of reappeared out of nowhere, but it's cool that somebody hung on to it because
it's historical.
Yeah.
So one thing that's kind of interesting is that, like, some of the different jobs that exist in the brewery, especially a larger one like your New Belgium. How about the folks that do blending? Like you mentioned, Lauren and Eric. Like, how do you get that job? Like,
yeah, I want to know that.
That's a sweet one.
like with anything in New Belgium, I think that they showed a ton of initiative and they showed interest in initiative in working with the sour beer program.
And aptitude too.
Yeah,
sure.
Exactly. Yeah. Well, yeah. And they, you know, obviously they would have turned out great. Cool. So
there's also folks, I mean, there's folks that take care of the fermenters as well. Are those the cellar people?
Yep. Like, yep. So we have our production departments right now. There is sort of some division, although we try to not have it that way, but there is sort of a brew house, cellar, and a packaging groups. Okay. And they have their kind of, those are their departments. You know.
And packaging, of course, are the ones that are getting into final kegs, bottles, and cans.
Yep, exactly.
So I think after all this talk about the generalities of beer, we should have some beers.
Absolutely.
I think we'd probably start with Fat Tire.
Yeah, yeah.
And so I think, I mean, is it technically an amber ale? Is that what people are calling it these days? And I mean, as you said, this style itself was actually fairly common in Belgium.
Yeah, yeah. And so kind of fitting that the most common style of ale in Belgium is an amber ale. Or at least, I don't know if that's true anymore, but it certainly was. So, it's very much modeled after, I would say, a Palm or a Deconic.
As far as flavor goes, yeah. I mean, like, nice, just even quenching. It actually finishes quite dry. Like, it's like, in spite of a, like, you often think of ambers as fairly malty beers, but I find it's fairly dry. Like, nice medium body. I mean, it's basically, if you had to just drink a beer every day and you wanted like, this is like, hey, I want to grab a beer. This is a great beer to do it with.
I love the fact that it's always on tap in restaurants because I think I love it with food.
Yeah, no, it's super solid beer. Really, I mean, people don't, you know, you sort of fail to appreciate like how flavorful it actually is. I mean, as us beer nerds, we're always kind of beating up our palate. And if you don't and you have this, you're like, wow, it's really, you know, a lot of flavor to it. And then for someone who's a more mainstream drinker, this is over the top for them.
Oh, I remember the very first time I had this because, I mean, I was used to drinking just kind of big beer, big yellow beer kind of things.
Yeah.
You know, it was super huge at the time. I mean, you'd lose your perspective, I guess, or I lose
mine. Well, it's a 22-year-old recipe.
And to this day, I think it's honestly one of the, I still think it's one of our, it's definitely most drinkable.
Super drinkable. I mean, it's insanely drinkable.
Great beers.
Do you think we should do Abbey next? Is that probably the?
I think yeah, Abbey before we go into Hoppy.
That's a double, right? Like it's
It is. It's Belgian style double, so it's got quite a bit of yeast character to it. But I think that, you know, it gets pretty big from here on out. Yeah. I think that Abbey probably...
That makes sense. And this, as we talked about earlier, was one of the first beers as well, wasn't it?
Like, it is.
So it's going to be a little bit more malty, maybe like a slightly more residual sweetness.
Yeah, you can kind of tell by the color. There's a little bit more caramel in there.
Yeah, for sure.
A little bit of chocolate.
So you get a lot of, I mean, it's a bit of grassy hoppiness and then really lovely caramel. And
for me, I think the key player in Abbey is the yeast. It's got a real... what I call Belgian yeast, but it's probably not a very good word for it.
You get those like esters. And
yeah,
like
kind of candy banana and maybe some cloves.
Yeah, I like when that candy comes out that you're sort of like, you don't expect kind of like almost a rock, almost bubblegummy candy kind of.
We also use circus peanuts, but also the runts, you know, the banana runt, the candy runts.
Oh, really?
We use that as the descriptor for this beer.
Yeah, that's a fair, I mean, it does have a very nice estery quality, then nice malt, but, you know, a little residual sugar, but also dry. Like it's not, it's finishing nice and...
Yeah, the candy banana is in the aroma. I don't really get a lot of sweetness in the flavor.
That is a really tasty beer. And so you think to the Ranger?
Off to Hopland. So with the Ranger, we went with pretty traditional IPA. The Cascade hop's really the backbone of this beer.
Yeah.
And
so like citrus, pine, kind of should be.
Yeah.
Do you dry hop a lot? Like you guys do like late editions and dry hopping a fair amount? Or?
We do, yeah. Late kettle edition and dry hops. We tend to try to use hops that are lower in alpha so we can use more of them. I think the key to this beer for me personally was drying it out. We went really dry with a cooler mash, a longer, colder mash.
Yeah. It's got a huge, really lovely, citrus and pine on the nose. Like, this one is just...
It's a lot of cascade.
Yeah, it fills your nostrils.
There's some Simcoe and Chinook in there, too.
Yeah, it's got a nice kind of orange rind kind of hoppiness to it in the taste as well, but it's not overly bitter. Your beer, do you try and make all your beers really, really dry? Kind of dry them out a lot, attenuate them? This one, again, seems pretty...
It depends on the beer. With Fat Tire, is actually a little higher gravity, just because it is more subtle, so the sweetness kind of gives it more going on. But with something like Ranger, where there's so much hops, I think that bitter and sweet combined are kind of gross.
Yeah.
So we wanted to go with real dry.
More pure,
dry. Real dry, real crisp finish, hoppy, bitter.
Yeah, no, really tasty. And the rampant, rampant's kind of just the summer? Last few months? It's fairly new, isn't it?
Rampant's actually super new. So Rampant, we made, it's an Imperial IPA.
Yeah.
We want it to be entirely different from Ranger, so we use totally different hops. This one's Centennial, Mosaic, and Calypso hops.
Yeah, I've heard Mosaic's becoming pretty popular, like mango and pineapple Mosaic, and stuff.
Mosaic's a funny one. It was popular before it even had a name.
Oh, really?
Yeah, it was Hop 369, it was already...
Oh, you're kidding.
The darling of
That's interesting, because this is very pale as well, it's interesting, because sometimes you pour a double IPA or an Imperial IPA, and it's got a real caramelness to it. But.
Yeah, and I think a lot of times brewers will go for that real heavy caramel for balance.
Yeah.
But again, I think... For me, a nice dry, crisp finish with that big hop aroma.
Yeah, it's nice mango-y. I get a lot of...
Yeah, it's much more tropical.
Yeah. Definitely some more bitterness. Higher IBUs for sure.
Yeah.
How high is this one? Is this in the 80s or...?
So this one's 85 BUs.
Okay, that's
and 8.5% alcohol. So a little bit warmer, a little bit more bitter.
The tropical and spicy for me, this is really neat. And like you said, some of them are very caramelly and toffee-like in their malt. This one... Just enough malt to support those really big hops. It's really nice. So moving on, this is now into the...
Shifting gears in a pretty big way.
And it's these aren't really very much hopped at all. They're typically these type of beers. So they're actually, it's interesting from a palate perspective, they're pretty safe to drink after a very hopped beer because you got a very, it goes this totally random direction on your palate.
I think so, yeah. And specifically because you want, in order to get the bacterial growth that you need to present to create these sour flavors, you don't really want hops.
Because they're bactericidal. They're antibacterial, antiviral. So
yeah.
So they have the Transatlantic. This I've had before and I know is amazing. So
yeah, this is actually one of my favorite beers. Well, you were asking earlier about food pairings. My personal favorite food pairing is this with a ribeye.
Oh, really?
You know, it's like wine with steak. Tart tannin from the fruit grease from the steak.
Yeah, this is more vinous, that vinous quality. And it even looks wine-ish, but you have that cherry, like you said, those cherry tannins, the dark cherry. Look at this, a very slight pinkness to the foam. That's not the coolest thing.
This and a nice fat marbled ribeye. Yeah, my favorite beer.
I'm a vegetarian, so I have to find my alternative. Maybe a piece of barbecue tofu or something. Yeah, cherry.
Yeah, the amount he uses is insane. This is a fun beer to create because. There's so much that goes into the color.
Yeah.
The compound that makes cherries red is pH dependent. So at 3.8, they're reddest.
Okay.
And if they go higher than that, they turn brown, when they rot.
Oh, okay.
If you go lower, they turn pink.
Right.
So we nailed 3.8.
Right.
To get it's reddest.
That is very cool. It's because people don't realize, sours are actually in that. 3 to 4 pH, which is fairly acidic.
Sure, and when the lambic comes to us, it's actually more acidic than that. But we build our base beer so that when they marry, it'll hit 3.8.
And it is sour cherry beer. But it's exceptional, and it's got this acidity that just runs through it. Like you said, this could compete with almost any wine.
Yeah, I think this is probably my favorite beer.
Yeah, it's pretty awesome. I know I like La Folie a lot too. So. But let's just see how it goes. I know I like La Folie. I'm a sucker for La Folie. So this was one of the first sours I had, and I've actually used it to introduce a lot of other people to sours and folks that may not otherwise not. And then for the folks on TV, a sour is a fairly acidic beer that has a sour flavor, but lots of other interesting complexity. And this beer in particular has just so many different qualities that make it unique.
So this beer is produced. in a manner that's pretty similar to the way Rodenbach is made. I mean, it's our benefit of having a Belgian brewmaster from Rodenbach.
Yeah. It's a little cloudy on this one, as you might expect.
No one's. I don't know if it's called a sour brown or sour red. I've heard people go back and forth about that, but
it's some kind of Flanders beer. Yeah. Flat oud
brewing. Depending on how you hold it, it can be brown or red.
Yeah. So yeah, I mean, super tart, lots of overripe fruit, and
I get a pretty strong presence of oak.
Just so good in the finish, like with the, I always get like really plum and dark black cherry. I mean, it's funny, the cherry's not like that at all, but definitely more plummy, and I want to have this after that one. But it's interesting because folks will fake this style of beer, the creeks, like they'll put like cherry extracts in and stuff like that.
Oh, right, yeah.
And it's so obvious when you've had a real one,
right?
Because you can tell it's right in the fiber. I mean, I think what's amazing about this is there's no way you could simulate this because this level of complexity, like you said, like the tannins and then the sort of this dark fruit and then there's just this strong sourness that just sort of permeates it. Like, yeah, the nose just keeps on stuff coming off it. Like, wow, I mean, it's a great way to finish.
Yeah.
I don't know what else to say other than thank you for letting us try these because these are, I mean, it's a great lineup, great beers. Yeah, I always declare my favorite beer and I mean, it is the La Folie. I mean, I kind of knew that going in. I'm not usually swayed, but I got to say the Rampant kind of swayed me a little bit. Like I think that just that really interesting, like tropical plus spicy kind of really. And I mean, I knew this was like super close, but La Folie.
La Folie
is the winner again. I knew it from the beginning, and I mean, it lived up to it as always. So thank you so much for having us. I mean, it's been great to try these and also learn a bit about yourself, like the brewery, the people here, the culture. It's really an awesome place.
My pleasure.
Yeah, so it's been great. So,
cheers.
Cheers. Skol. Na zdrovje. Kanpai.
Sorry.
I forgot one. We learned one yesterday. I forgot it already. I'll have to go back to the old film.
Prost.
Prost. There we go. I just. Prost.